Hi, I'm Jennifer Schaefer, and this is, you're listening to Hacking the Afterlife podcast with
Rich Martini. Hello, Jennifer. How are you?
Hey, Richard. I'm doing well. How
you're
are you?
Doing well, I feel like I haven't seen you in a blue moon, and I haven't seen you in so long, the background behind you has shifted.
A little bit. I move my office around a little bit.
All right. I just want to make sure. And as you can tell with me, my forest hasn't changed at all. I'm still sitting in a forest somewhere in the suburbs of Chicago.
I love it. I love it. So I wasn't here last Thursday. Sorry about that. But
weren't? Who was I talking to? She looked just like you. I'm kidding. No, I'm so sorry. Tell us where you were. What were you doing?
I was at United Artists, UTA. We had a big meeting with 18 executives.
18 of them. Wow, I love that. Was it like in the movies when you go in there and they all sit there and go, you know, tell us the future?
Round table, the biggest table I've ever seen in my life. Wow. And they all knew about my life more so than probably I did.
So they had done their research. That's good.
Yeah.
Was it like the way they do it in comedies where everybody was like acting like they really knew a lot about you, but they were making stuff up, or no?
Yeah, they could have. I mean, you know, it's interesting. It was very interesting. It was great, though. It was great.
The show Hacks. I don't know if you've seen the show Hacks. It won the Emmy for Best Comedy, but they've had a couple of, you know, those scenes. Anyway, but can you tell us anything about what you're doing, or no, not yet?
There's just a couple of shows developed around me and the work I do. So,
okay. Well,
yeah. So it's great.
Will you cast someone to play me?
Probably.
Here's a bobblehead of Max Muncy, the Dodger. You could just have that off camera. And where'd you go? Oh, there you are. Okay.
Right there. But it's been, you know, I've had a very busy, very busy week. I had a huge event Friday night, and then
tell us about that. Also, you did the Uncorked last night, I think.
Uncorked last night. They give me a little mic, which works great. There's 35 people, and everybody gets a reading.
Wow!
Put That's everybody's name in a little, you know, little basket, and it's quite entertaining. It's a lot of fun. I absolutely love it. I love people that love my
Please, if you don't mind, for people tuning in for the first or last time, when you say people put a question in a basket, what kind of questions?
No. So what they do is they put their first name and their last initial, and then they put that into a wine bucket, actually. And everybody gets a glass of wine. They're all over the place, this little place called Uncorked in Manhattan Beach. And I've been going there now for years, and I forced myself to be uncomfortable and read the audience. But instead of going up there saying, okay, I have Uncle Bob here, they get to ask a question, or they get to ask, you know, they want to talk to their mom, Aunt Mary, or whatever. They have to tell me the first name because it's a target. Every medium is different. And so that's how I work, by having their name in front of me and having whatever I'm able to connect. And it's just super fun. It's a really fun night, and it's entertaining, but it's just forced me to do so. I used to terrify me doing that. And my other medium friends are like, why would you ever do that? Go person to person when there's so many dead people around. I'm like, well, not everybody wants to talk to the dead, you know? So it's a lot.
Sometimes people just go and listen in. They don't have any questions.
Yeah, they don't have any questions. I had writers and producers coming for months they had to write a pitch, and then they picked the writer that wrote the best pitch. But yeah, I've been interviewed lots and lots and lots for quite a while now, but it's a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun. But I had to tell you something. So I had a friend of mine that was going to give me a book that he wrote, and he met me there, and it's called Heavenland, a nice novel by Brett Johnson. And the reason why I'm bringing this up is because in the back, I was reading the back, and I'm so, you know, other than your books, I love this book. And it talks about, imagine if you died tomorrow, take a breath. What did you leave behind? Do you have any regrets? And it goes on, and he's like, in this story where fantasy meets facts, a 46-year-old man dies and enters in a new world, creating his own version of heaven. Brett immediately finds himself in an acoustic jam with Bob Marley and Jimi Hendrix.
Wow.
It says that on the back, and I'm like, what? And then I sent him a message. I'm like, I love your book, but I'm like, oh my gosh, you have to understand, Jimi Hendrix is everywhere. Every time people go to the other side, he's usually either
Talk to a host or
ghost or
yeah,
like
no,
a,
you've
but I
heard
just found that that's the reason why I brought up the book. It's a great book, but that's the reason why I brought up the book. I thought that was pretty fascinating that, and he wrote this a while ago, so I
that. Yeah.
found
That's
that.
great. And you know, it's funny because somebody out there in Quora land wrote a note saying, gee, I wish you guys would talk to Bob Marley. And what I like to say is, you know, if you've been listening to the show, we tend to show people how they can ask questions to whoever it is that they love, whoever it is they like, and see what the answers are. I mean, you know, especially if you're a big fan of somebody, you know, and you want them to come forward and you want to hear have a question, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, I think it's always amusing when you watch somebody else do an interview with somebody. That's great.
I think it's great. And the other thing that was funny too with one of the clients, I'm like, I have a lot of clients that find me through you, either Quora or through this podcast, which super happy about because I love them because they always come with their questions and who did
They
they
badger
meet?
you.
Who did they meet in the afterlife? And one of them, I'm like, I don't know why Prince is showing up, and they're like, we just got a dog and we named him Prince. But Prince showed up, but it wasn't like, I'm like, it doesn't, it's not the musician Prince, but it has to do with Prince. But he showed up to show that, but it was
Just
very.
to give you the word, and I mean, for people tuning in, that's kind of how we work and how you work, which is. Somebody on the flip side gives you a clue, like a visual clue. I'll tell you, I got an email from a guy this morning. I mean, I think he sent it a while ago. I just didn't notice it, but he was trying. He tried, you know, based on what we've said. So he wanted to ask Robert Towne, you know, the screenwriter from Chinatown and our friend who has shown up quite often in our podcast, wanted to ask him some questions. And so he sort of well, I mean, does Robert want to come forward and talk about it? I don't know, but I mean, I could say what the.
He said, I think this is for Hira.
Oh, that's funny. Well, in this case,
I know Robert.
he got three images from Robert.
Okay.
Again, this is a person I don't know, is just doing a meditation, and so he's asking Robert this question, something along the lines of, "How are you doing?" Or, you know, what's going on? And the three images that came to mind were a skull, but like an X-ray of a skull, like a head with an X-ray, and then an X-ray of a torso, like the upper torso, like around your heart, and then the comedy drama mask, the theater, you know, happy and sad. You know, that's the universal
Yeah.
symbol for theater. And he immediately thought, uh-oh, is Robert trying to tell me I should worry about my health and I should go get a CAT scan and an X-ray? But and Robert can answer the question, but here's what I
I
came up
don't. I don't feel like that was it, but go ahead.
with. But so Robert, correct me if I'm wrong. I'm now, you know, thinking like
He
what
loves, first of all, he says, I love to correct you, so go ahead.
Please. But I was thinking the first thing is the head, which is how we predominantly scan the planet. That's how we experience the planet. It all is in our head, and that's our experience. But the second thing, and the most important thing, is the heart, because that's the thing that connects us to everybody.
That
That
connects us to the unseen.
connects us to the unseen. And then the third thing, the comedy drama is to say this is the metaphor that we experience while we're on stage. We do have comedy, we do have drama, and Jennifer's tapping her nose, meaning that's correct. So, but that idea of the third thing is all three are equally important, but all three require all these different elements, which is the mind, the heart, and then realizing we're in the midst of a play here that
right.
we've created, and we're trying to work things out or help people or whatever it is, whatever the lessons are. So I got a more of a metaphor of the theater than what this guy was worried about. I mean, you know, he sent me this email saying, you know, should I go get myself and, you know.
No, he should definitely just get an annual checkup just to, so he doesn't think about it, but it's not, I think your interpretation or Robert's, what he was trying to give, he's still learning how to do it.
He's still learning how to do it, but you know, I think it's fascinating, and I encourage people to do that, which is ask your loved ones, ask people that you want to talk to questions like that. Don't take them too personally or too, you know, with fear, because they're not going to tell you something that's fear-based, and they're not going to warn you about something, because that's not their job. You have your own journey to work.
Even when someone from our class warned me to tell this person in front of me, I just didn't want to say it. But, and I looked for the outcome that this person would be fine, but it was pretty serious, you know. But it's never anything that's going to say, they're not going to give you something. They can't, how would I explain this?
Disrupt your path.
Correct. This had to do with the stalker. This had to do with security, getting security beefed up. And so I said so many words. They knew what I was saying, but I was mortified because they didn't want to get it wrong. And then when you get in that fear base, and I'm a seasoned vet at this, I'd like to say I've done thousands and thousands and thousands of hours of readings. So I'm saying that in the context of it's taken me a long time to not only understand how it works, but if I have any fear with what I do for work, and that's, you know, when they give me something like that, I'm going to have a little bit of fear.
Yeah.
Then I get in my head and I can get the interpretation wrong.
I see. Suddenly you become, the fear takes over and you start to worry.
And so in the beginning, that did a lot. And what got me to really settle down from that was working all the cases. I've worked on two cases today that are nutty, and they're cold cases, but I know. Last night, I actually
asked. That's a good way to put it. They're nutty.
Last night I asked, because everybody wanted to know certain questions. I love my groups at Uncorked, but I finally said, well, does anybody just want to find a dead body? I'm really good at that.
Sorry. I might have laughed too loud on that. All right. Well, listen, we always like to ask our friend Luana, our moderator on the flip side, if she has anybody on her guest list that she wants to bring forward. I've been thinking about her recently because I've been working on a book proposal that includes her. So I've been sort of going over, you know, past events and stuff like that. But Lou, anything you want to say?
No, Jimi Hendrix is here. And they just showed me that whole
said his name and boom, now he's here.
I'm doing this. And then,
well, let's ask him what's going on. How are you, sir? And I know we've spoken to you before. What would you like to add to our discussion?
Oh, I love that. Huh. And Robert Towne, because this is about a guy that went to heaven and his dog was there.
Oh, I see. Okay, yeah, that's the high risk question.
That's so crazy.
Okay, very good.
Okay. Anyway.
So one at a time. Jimmy, what is it that's going on with you? Why? And please, I've heard you say this before, but explain to our audience, why is it that you do show up so often to greet people on the flip side?
Because everybody knows who I am. You know, sorry. if I showed up, I mean, this is sad, but he's like, if I showed up to somebody, some, you know, white female in Manhattan Beach, and they didn't know I was Jimi Hendrix, they think I was probably a crook. Like I'm going to go steal something, or I'm going to go, like, it wouldn't be the same profiling.
Everyone recognizes you because even though you left the planet,
yeah,
when you're in your 20s,
it's fun for me because I'm not just playing the guitar. I'm not stuck in that timeline. I'm not just playing the guitar and rock and rolling and all the other things. He's just like, because I like the ukulele better. He goes, I like, you know, being a TV host. He goes, that's easy. Now they're all making fun of him.
Well, talk to us a little bit about the instrument, the ukulele. How is it you create that so you can play it? How do you create that with your mind?
Once again, he goes, it's your interpretation and what sounds good to you. It's heavenly.
But I mean, are you creating the instrument, the wood, the strings?
Everything, the smell, the even the hands being rough, from playing. Hold on. That's how we create everything. We base it upon our memories, our collective mem collective from your lifetimes or everybody's. So he's like, I'm like, so is it the collective from everybody, or is it the collective from all your soul, like your soul and all your lifetimes? And he said, and then he showed me Google, and he says it's Gottle, God, Gottle.
Oh, Gottle. That's pretty funny.
That
So
was kind
it's
of
not only all of your lifetimes, but it's all of everybody else's as
funny.
well.
That's why way more fun to have a lot more people involved with what you do, like
So let
for.
me ask you a question about this specifically. We talked to Paul Allen, who was a guy, the founder of Microsoft.
I feel like they're very good friends. He says we're very good friends.
And also, I think, he made him, he did a museum in your honor in Seattle. And when we asked Paul about what he was doing on the flip side, I asked him if he was playing the guitar, and he said he was learning how to play the ukulele because of the construction of it. And it was easier to do. You only have four strings, there's only so many chords. So let me ask you about that. Did
He said it was baby steps with him. And he said the museum should have been bigger.
Who said that, Jimmy or Paul?
Jimmy.
Jimmy. It should have been. It is only three floors. It could have been a lot more.
He was kidding about it, of course. But hold on, let me go back. He says it's not just easy, it just sounds better. The ukuleles they do over there just sound better. And you can play anything. You can play acoustic to anything.
Wow, it's interesting.
Guitar, like the guitar that he used to. One of the guitars, I'm sure he played many, brings a whole different energy.
Would you show that to Jennifer? Because Jennifer has this unique ability to see things. Show her a guitar that you might play. And what does it look like?
Feels like it's sharp, like it has this and then goes like
Sharp
that.
angles. Okay.
Angles, and it feels yellow to me.
Okay. So it's not literally based on like a Fender Stratocaster, but it's something you create over there. Is that correct?
That's the guitar, not the ukulele.
Yeah, no, that's what I mean. If you were going to play a like a guitar, what would you create?
The stratospheric version of it.
Stratocaster, okay, like a yellow Stratocaster. Is that correct?
Yeah.
I know what that is. So, I mean, I will hold up my blue one. That's what
Oh,
it
yeah.
looks something like that. There you go. If I could only play it the way he played his. Of course, he played his upside down.
He says you don't practice enough.
I don't. You're right. That's true, Jimmy. I appreciate that. And in terms of we're hanging out with Paul, I mean, Paul crossed over so many years after you.
I know, I did think of you guys this morning too. That's interesting. So I saw something with Brett Favre.
Okay.
And
Very good. Jennifer
yeah.
just made a connection.
I thought of them this morning before I even read the back of this book, before I even talked to you. Like, it's so funny. Like,
That's so profound.
so I
Well,
thought about Ellen, and I thought then it was just one of those moments that go, and then I was on to something else. But
so let me
yeah.
connect those dots for the audience tuning in. We talked to Paul Allen when he first crossed over. We asked him who greeted him, Junior Seau. And Dave Duerson came forward. Jennifer identified them because of the numbers on their jerseys, which I knew. Say I was 55 and Dave Duerson was 22. But Dave Duerson was the first person who had whose brain was diagnosed with CTE. And Junior Seau also took his own life from CTE a year later. And they had come to greet Paul Allen to thank him for creating the Brain Institute that he had done. Now, Brett Favre today announced that he has Parkinson's. And what Junior and Dave came to tell us through on three different occasions, it took us three times to figure out what they were saying, but that Joe Namath had cured CTE using oxygen therapy on his brain. Joe Namath, still on the planet, had cured his CTE. And so Brett Favre should know that you can help these kind of brain issues using, is that correct?
Yeah, they're already on it. They said they've been very busy this morning. That's why they showed it to me in my head, but they've been busy all along.
Okay.
You.
And how would you help? How do you help somebody? What do you do? What's the knocking on their door or ringing their phone? Or how do you get into their head to get them to focus on this?
They get into somebody else's head that's retired, or they get into somebody else's head. He's been probably inundated by people because it's now a lot more common from, they were
Sure.
filmed getting knocked out, right?
Sure.
And so there's people that have had to deal with CTE. It's so much more common now. And not just field in the NFL, but in a lot of
And you
different.
mentioned that they've shown you boxers and other people that were athletes that had brain injuries that had it, but they've never been diagnosed as having it.
Right.
So now listen, it also, and let me ask about this because maybe you guys know on the flip side, maybe you don't. But there was a thing about Parkinson's in the Washington Post yesterday saying that Parkinson's, the genesis of it came from the gut, that it was like the biome of the gut that something went wrong or it caused a genetic predisposition that eventually then caused the issues in the brain. So it's almost like they were saying we were looking in the wrong direction. Let me ask you guys, is that accurate? Is that something people should focus on?
Part of it, yeah. The gut controls everything.
I don't know if you remember this, Jennifer, but
No.
it was a session
Me
I
go ahead and say no.
did. Well, it was a session I did with Coleman Hoff, the screenwriter who had Parkinson's. It was Scott and I did the session. I mean, we filmed her, and she has had severe Parkinson's. And during the session, she went and talked to her guides, and they told her that they were saying to her, and she was saying it, I realized what caused my Parkinson's, and it had to do with my diet and what I was eating and how I had changed my diet and the predisposition, et cetera, et cetera. And so
I think
I
that,
saw
yeah.
the connection of those dots. Anyway, I just wanted to point that out.
They're working on it overtime. I'm like, is that why you came through? And he goes, yeah, pretty much. I mean, think about all the people over there that have died from it. Like Junior, how like all the people over there that have died from it. He says, there's a whole fleet of people that don't, it's just so unnecessary now. Like it's just so, it's devastating to have these things happen.
Yeah. Well, I'm glad to hear that people are focusing on it. It's
Over
important.
there here.
All right. So let's, Robert, you were the other person that stopped by, and Luana, of course, very
He's
close
the one
friends with
that
Robert.
showed me
Yeah.
Heavenland.
So let's talk to Hira. Now, it's unusual that Jennifer and I have been doing this for a while, and Robert Towns' dog, Hira, who I spent a lot of time walking around and, taking care of when Robert's directing movies. He has come through consistently to talk to us about the animal perspective.
Yeah, and he said, I'm like, so are you a horse yet? And he goes, no, I'm still the dog.
And he did recall during one of our conversations while Robert was on the planet, Robert was having conversations with Hira, his dog who had passed away 40 years ago, via Jennifer, and learning things like that he had been a horse in a previous lifetime.
Yeah, in the video that I sent you too, that was really cool.
Amazing.
That's
Yeah.
cool. Yeah. Oh, he wants to talk about me because I gave up too quickly, apparently. When a dog came in last night and she's like, I don't remember. And then I'm like, I stopped it or whatever. But
Oh, you mean during your uncorked session, the dog
yeah,
kicked through?
like don't give up so easily. Dogs have so much to say.
Oh, interesting. Interesting.
Like, sorry. Okay.
Hira, what did she miss out on?
I mean, it felt like a cat, but it was a dog. It was like a little fluffy thing, and I got that wrong.
A small animal.
A small animal, that's what I needed to say. It was my
Well, don't you see things sort of translucently? So it would be more like a light, right? What they showed up.
but they trying to get it right. I mean, okay, thank you. That helps. Like some people have body dysmorphia. Dogs might show themselves like this, they're this huge dog, but they might be this little dog. They show me more of their spirit than they do how they
Ah,
act.
of course, of course. We've heard
So that's,
this.
I think, where I get it wrong. Well, it doesn't.
And we've heard this from people.
I still gave them messages, but he just keep pointing to that book. Like, animals are sentient beings. They're so special and so amazing, you know?
And you can ask them questions about their journey and how they found us. Because that's the most fascinating thing is when they tell us that all along they had been with us before in a previous lifetime and then found a way to track us down and found a way to get us to go to the pound to pick them up. And then when we see them, it's like, oh, there you are. And we think we've created all that, but we just don't realize that they're a part of that process as well.
Nope.
But also, it's just like you said, they may appear as a smaller individual, like Jimi Hendrix showing up to people on the flip side when we talk to them, and they're like, this is the weirdest thing. Jimi Hendrix is here, and he's not playing a guitar, but he's like talking to me, but I recognize him instantly.
Isn't
That's
that so cool? That
well,
was
I'll tell you,
so.
and that relates to our friend Chuck, who was the first person who told us that he saw Jimmy sitting in the Johnny Carson chair on the Tonight Show interviewing him.
Yeah.
Johnny was in the audience. And so, I mean, there's that Charles Grodin, the actor, when he passed, he said, that's who.
Sorry. I just asked him, well, Jimmy, are you just some type of like angel of death? And he goes, not of death. I'm just the greeter of death.
Angel of greeting angel.
Yeah, a greeting angel. It's just too much. Like, there's so much about that that keeps
Well,
coming up.
I did want to reel Chuck in for a minute, Charles Grodin, and let's ask him, what did you think of last night?
Oh, he was overwhelmed. He was overwhelmed.
Okay.
I think they messed up in the middle, but they recuperated in the end.
Interesting. So we're referring to a documentary that Charles Grodin stars in, and it was shown in a movie theater last night in Santa Monica, and I went with the family and some friends. And a lot of my friends have reached out to me today. They said they had no idea how deep and profound. Charles spent a good part of his life saving people in prison, getting them out of prison. And so, Chuck, do you want to talk about that? Somebody asked the question, why would he give up his movie career or a big movie star to do that kind of work?
I did whatever was more profound. Heaven Can Wait was profound. He did Heaven Can Wait. But when he can save a life, or especially an unjust life that was, wrongly accused or whatever it is, think of all the people that they get to affect now when they're out, or that they get to love, and the families that get reunited. And he said that's so much more profound.
See, now Jennifer couldn't know what she's referring to, what Charles is referring to, but he single-handedly changed the Rockefeller laws in New York State, where if you had 2 ounces of any controlled substance from 1973 on, you got 15 years to life in prison. So wives of husbands who said, deliver this to my friend, a lot of times they were set up by a policeman, whatever, they got paid off. And they were doing 20 to life. And then Chuck single-handedly changed those laws. And he went to see these women in prison every weekend for about 5 years. He took me once. We went up to Bedford Prison and met with this woman, June. It's very profound what he did. And they have them on camera talking about how he saved their lives. And they think about while they were in prison and how there was just no way they would never see their family again, except in a pine box, as one put it. And all of them got out of prison thanks to one guy, Charles Grodin. It's pretty unique. So I'm just saying, Jennifer doesn't really know that that's what he's talking about, but that is what he's referring to.
What he
But
was showing me. He's like, I would do that. There was never a question of what meant more.
But was
And
it related to you as a youth? Was that because there were people in the film who talked about how you were completely like a lover of all people when you were like in grade school. Was that connected to that, or where did the injustice
I
part?
just never wanted any 13, he said. I saw somebody get beaten up by that being the wrong color.
Oh, okay.
And I just knew that was wrong. Like, it's wrong to begin with, but on such a different level of hate that he didn't like it look like, he's showing me like the Ku Klux Klan or whatever, swastika.
Yeah.
Just like with what the Germans did to the Jewish people. I just knew if I wasn't going to be an attorney, I had to act like one, had to hire them. I knew that I'd be able to make more. I knew by doing movies that I could make more money than to help people with it, kind of thing. Like, he didn't do movies to be famous. He did movies because I could now afford to do other things to help people.
Well, it was interesting because at some point he sort of retired after Beethoven, the dog movie. He retired to because he wanted to take care of his son, raise his
Again, another dog.
dog. But Chuck wanted to be at home with his son, but at the same time he wanted to do something. So he had this idea to do a talk show, and the talk show for the first couple of years was a comedy show. You know, he had a lot of comedy guests on there. But then it slowly drifted into this kind of show where he talked about, you know, people's lives and how he could change them. And I was like one of the producers on the show, and he made me go around to like homeless shelters and prisons and film people telling their story. And then I'd bring the footage back and he would use that
I think
in
that's why you're so good at interviewing the other side and interviewing people in general and getting in their heads. Did that come from Chuck, or were you always that curious?
Well, let's give him credit. Why not? No, I think I shared this with Chuck.
He
Chuck
says
is,
that he had Johnny Carson to thank for it too, and Paul
well, that's
Hunt.
interesting because there's a lot of the film has Johnny in it,
Yeah.
and people talk about Martin Short and Steve Martin. They talk about how Chuck turned the whole format of talk shows into something else, where he interviewed the person who was interviewing him, and no one had ever done that with Johnny Carson before. Where he like teased Johnny Carson and made him answer questions instead of Chuck answering the questions. But yeah, he was a master at that. But I would say this, Chuck used to say something to me. There are two kinds of people in the world, people who like people and people who don't like people. And he was one of those who liked people. And I see of myself as somebody, I'm interested in people. So I have no fear of asking people the most inane, ridiculous questions because I'm curious. So
Right.
that's what I shared with him. Just
Wow.
no fear of, you know, hierarchy or who, where somebody is in the, you know, the school of whatever.
And like he said that last night was like another send-off again.
That's what it felt like, yeah.
And he said it was way more crowded. Everybody wanted to see what they were doing from the other side. The whole class and the whole, imagine 10 of our classes.
Oh, so all the people there were able to watch that film. So what Jennifer's saying, so just so I'm clear, the documentary was about 90 minutes. We're in a theater of like, you know, 500 people. People on the flip side can come
Thousands.
watch move, thousands can come and watch the movie, not just through my eyes, but all the people that are in the audience, they're watching it. You know, they're not taking up seats, but they are there in the room.
So I have figured this out. I believe it's so much easier for them to see movies in a movie theater because it's dark. So I don't know if it's like that with you, but every time I'm in the movie theater, I am freezing cold with the chills because there's so many spirits that are around.
Well, that's
You have the content, and I can see them when the movie goes up. They're more apparent. I'm like, oh my gosh, it's crowded here. Which always indicated a good movie for me. But
yeah.
yeah.
Well, I'll tell you, I did see a number of friends of Chuck's whose family members who were also off the planet. And I did talk to an actor who lost a close friend of his, you know, earlier on in life. And I was trying to say to him, tune into our podcast, because not only does Charles Grodin show up, but we also demonstrate how you can bring your loved ones into the room to talk to them. What's on your mind?
Oh, Joaquin Phoenix, his brother.
Oh, River Phoenix. Okay. I wasn't thinking of him, but River Phoenix would be.
No, I know you weren't. They were just putting that in my head.
No.
There's a lot of young actors that passed away.
You know, early in life. That's what I'm taught. It was somebody who lost their life in the middle of their journey. I don't want to say their name, because even when I said that to this friend of this person, he looked at me like, what? What are you saying?
Who's this Amy? Who's Amy? Amy, the one that died, the singer?
Oh, the
British singer died.
Yeah, I know who you mean.
Cannot believe I cannot think
of that. Her name, Amy?
I don't know. I almost was like,
I know who you mean. Is she here?
She just popped in, like, with all the people that have died around the same time, like between, you know, the Joker, who was, what's his name? You know who I'm talking about. We're playing this
River
game now.
Phoenix, that's right. And
the one that played the Joker.
Oh, no, I know who you mean. Heath Ledger. And have we talked? I think we've talked to Heath.
There's a whole, like, crew up there that are just like, I can't believe we're gone. You know?
So do those guys show up as well?
Kurt Cobain just showed up.
Okay, that's Kurt. People have asked me if we talked to Kurt. We've interviewed Kurt years ago. Does he want to say anything? It's welcome to, if he wants.
I'm still trying to get that person's name. That
we'll ask Kurt. He would know her. What's her name? Come on.
Winehouse, for fuck's sake.
Winehouse. Thank you, Miss Winehouse. No, I don't
say it. Sorry about that. I didn't mean to.
No, go ahead. Amy, what do you think about the movie that they made about you?
I didn't know if I liked it, because it was a sure sign that I was no longer there. And she's just laughing. Like, they didn't get my good side all the time. It was well done. Well done. The best that they could have done.
Okay. Okay. Any messages you have for your fans or people like that?
It's so funny. So they're all like Aretha Franklin with her movie. They're all coming and saying, there was a movie made about me. There's a movie made about me.
That's true.
That's funny. I never put that together. It's very interesting. Hold on. Okay. Kurt Cobain from my generation is like that for your generation with Jimi Hendrix.
Ah, I see. That's right. Okay. And Kurt, we've talked to you before, but I mean, are you playing? Are you singing? Are you performing? Are you just watching over your family, or what are you doing?
He goes, no, I'm an altar boy. I'm not going to go near that stuff with the way that I left. Hold on.
But the music.
He's kidding about that. Give me a second. The music lives on forever, and so does how we passed.
The music goes on forever, and that's how we, what?
Because the music goes on forever, but so then does that we remember how he passed, how he shot himself.
I see.
You know, he wishes it would just be the music.
Ah, because we think about the exit of the stage rather than the time you spent on the stage.
Bingo.
I was thinking also of an actor named Phil Hartman, who was Saturday Night Live actor, who got killed. His wife had killed him. He was on Saturday Night Live, and yes, wow. She was a cocaine person, doing a lot of cocaine, and apparently they got in a fight, and Phil was a really funny comedian. He was on Pee Wee Playhouse and did a lot of other stuff. A very famous LA comedian and comic actor. And so I was thinking about Phil, and I wonder, one of these days we'll invite Phil to have a conversation.
We should. I don't know who he is, but we should.
Okay. Well, let's ask Luana. Does Phil want to say hi?
She's like, no, he's still trying to beat up his wife. It's just not working out that well.
Lou,
hold on. What's his last, what,
His first
Phil?
name is Phil, and last name is Hartman.
Sure.
Phil, take a seat. We've only got you for a few minutes. Thank you for coming in. Are you familiar with what we're doing?
He's like, did I have a choice?
You were yanked in. Do you know any of the people in our class?
He goes, everybody's kind of familiar with it.
Oh, what's your opinion?
It's interesting and it makes sense, but not everyone believes it on your side of the coin on how to connect with them.
So let me ask you, Phil, who greeted you when you crossed over?
He keeps showing me a dog.
Oh, okay. Like your dog that you had growing up.
Hold on. Some of his relatives feels like more like an aunt. And friends like John Belushi and a bunch of other ones. And Jimi Hendrix.
And Jimi Hendrix. Let me ask you this, people would want to know. Your wife left the planet just a few minutes later.
He just said that.
Yeah. And so what was that like when she crossed over? Was that, have you guys had,
She was going to kill me.
well, did have you guys had lifetimes before together?
Yeah.
Yes? Okay. So let me ask you, go ahead.
The whole thing was just a bad play. It was just stupid. Like how we, I think,
How you
just.
guys left the stage. Yeah, I understand that, and that's what people said. But let me ask you, was there any element that had been planned in advance, or was this something the drugs did?
It was not planned in advance. Oh, that's interesting. It's the drugs that did it.
It was the drugs, because they can alter your path while you're on the planet. And was it, have you resolved that with your wife? I mean, it's a weird thing to say.
Have to do it all over again, and she's going to be my daughter.
Is that true? So when are you coming back, if you don't mind me asking?
Not for a long time.
Okay, but the next time around, you'll.
Hopefully, the planet will still be intact, he says.
Hopefully, the planet will still be intact. Are you still hanging out with any of your friends? I want to say the name John. Are you hanging out with your friend John at all?
Yeah, but more of Stephen Hawk.
Mark Stephen Hawking. You mean
So,
the scientist?
yeah.
Well, tell us about that. What's it like to talk
Because
with?
if I'm going to come back, I need to know how to save the planet. I need to know all the ins and outs.
So, what was that like for you to meet Stephen Hawking, Phil?
I knew him from before, not on here, but I knew him from before.
From before, in a previous lifetime, or from off stage?
Previous lifetime. And I
Okay.
was always interested in how his brain worked.
Fascinating. And what kind of conversation do you guys have now?
Ah, interesting. How difficult it is to be physically disabled, like he was, and how I was mentally, because of the drugs, mentally in prison in a way, and
Interesting.
how comparing both.
So there is a connection here between Charles Grodin, because Charles was the one who got Phil onto Saturday Night Live. Now,
Oh,
What was it like for you when you saw Charles on the flip side, or when Charles came in
I said,
years?
oh no, you're here. What did you do?
Wow.
It was blissful. It was, I mean, Charles got a standing ovation over there from so many people. He's like, it took a while for me to get up, to say hello.
Oh, that's sweet. You had to wait.
There's so much more that the movie didn't show that he did as a human being.
Yes, I know. I know
I
it would
mean,
have been a
so
nine.
much his whole life in that short amount of time. But
No, I agree. And then other movies that I know, great stories.
what he said was, he goes, like we talked about, how I feel from the readings I've given, when you get over to the other side, you get asked if you loved well. And he said, he goes, Charles knocked it out of the park. That's all he did was love. When people didn't love themselves, he loved them and helped them. Yeah.
Beautiful.
Not in that kind of way.
I wasn't thinking that, but now that you mention it, No, anyway, it was just a delight to see people talking about your friend Charles Grodin, about what a wonderful guy he was from all these different walks of life, De Niro and Steve Martin and
Yeah. I wish I could have been there. You know, I couldn't have been, but
they'll have other screenings.
okay.
This guy made the film on his kind of on his own, so I think he's going to have a few screens. He's going to try to get into film festivals and stuff like that. So, but Chuck, I wanted to know what you thought about that screening and that idea that, and Luana, what about you? What's your opinion of that film? What do you think about it? I mean, it might be the same as Chuck's, it might be different.
She said she thought it was well done, but still more on the surface level. It feels like, I don't know. It feels like it went into deep stuff, so I don't understand that. But
Well, what do you mean, Lou? What do you mean in terms of deeper stuff?
he just did so much more, but it just might not have been that exciting for a movie.
I see. Oh yeah. Great stories. There were some they touched upon like
Yeah. Yeah, that's
surface
what she
stories.
said. Surface. They
Yeah,
touched.
but there were so many more. I know that hand clap means that Jennifer's got to go. Robert Town, you get the last word because you are a wordsmith. Come on in, give us one last word. What do you want to say?
He said, "Thank you for making it easier for me to cross over. You have no idea the peace you brought me."
He's talking to you, Jennifer.
No, he's talking about you as well.
You.
You're the one that always told him, "You gotta call Jennifer." You forced him to get online. Like
I did.
you're the one that did it. I wouldn't have even known.
And by the way, I think a lot of his friends and family are like, don't ever talk to Martini because he's gonna make you talk to the flip side. Well, whatever. Robert, we appreciate that.
Yeah. He just said thank you.
Jennifer,
Anyway.
thank you so much for your gifts. Thank you for being available this week. We know you're busy, and we're gonna be rooting for every step of your path and journey because we've been there. We were there. When we
Always been there.
hang out online through the pandemic and beyond.
Yep. Yep. All right.
All right, very good. Thank you. And we'll catch you on the flip side. Bye. This has been Hacking the Afterlife podcast with Jennifer Shaffer. For more information, jenniferschaefer.com, martinizone.com, or richmartini.com. Hacking the Afterlife documentary is available on Gaia.com via Amazon Prime.